In thinking about the coevolution between parasites and their hosts, we often hear that diseases, when they first attack a new host species, are likely to be really nasty, but after a while they might co-evolve to be less dangerous to their host. And this has led a number of evolutionary biologists and people who specialize in coevolution to ask whether that's true. Do parasites eventually evolve to become less harmful to their hosts? And if so, is that inevitable? Well, it turns out that the answer depends on the ecology of the host. Let me give you a kind of cartoon version of a very important concept, and that is of virulence. Virulence is when a pathogen spreads itself by reducing the survival of the host, okay? By making you feel horrible, by shutting you down. It's kind of like Sacalina turning its host crab into a robot so that it can then convert all of the resources into Sacalina eggs. Same idea, the pathogen harms its host in order to produce more copies of itself. Now let's consider how the parasite might be spread in a population. First, let's take a situation where it would really make sense for the parasite to show a very low level of virulence, okay? And this would be where the parasite spreads itself to one new host without killing its host. It wants to look after its host so it doesn't hijack too many of the resources of the host, and it just produces one offspring. So here it's produced its one offspring. The one offspring gets into another host, and the host lives. Okay, that's low virulence. Now let's consider a high virulence parasite, where this one can spread itself into a lot of new hosts, but it has to kill its host, its current host, in order to do so. So here it's making lots of copies of itself, but now it's hijacking so many of the host's resources, it's damaging to its current host. But meanwhile, it manages to spread itself to a lot of new hosts. Okay, that's high virulence. Now, I want to give an example of how we can test for the evolutionary plasticity of virulence by looking at a particular kind of parasite called a nematode, a little worm, that infects fig wasps. And fig wasps has a very peculiar ecology. In the fig wasps, a female lays her eggs in a fig, and all of her eggs are going to grow up in here, and the only other wasps that her babies are ever going to interact with are their siblings. Okay, so it's just within the family. So you have a single foundress here. She lays her eggs. She's infected, so she's got two offspring, and the infection goes with her from parent to offspring. Okay, and then the babies grow up. They leave. They go off somewhere else. They lay their eggs in yet another fig, and that's it. They never see any other figs except during that one time they were back in the fig that they were born in. Now, when this transmission is strictly from parent to child, that's called vertical transmission, okay? And in this case, the parasite really needs to make sure that its host is going to stay healthy till it gets to a new fig, lays its eggs, starts the whole cycle over again. So the parasite has to be really careful to be nice to its host. So virulence should be really low when transmission is vertical. But there are other species of fig wasps where multiple foundresses lay their eggs in the same fig. So in this case, there's a chance for transmission to go from one set of eggs to another. So this can go sideways in the same generation. That's called horizontal transmission. In this case, it can pay to be really nasty to your current host if by so doing you're able to infect lots of new hosts. Okay? Here's an advantage to go sideways. And then they'll go off and have many more copies in future generations, even though they might kill one of their original hosts. So with horizontal transmission, that's an unrelated individual to another, the parasites can spread at the expense of their host. They can still end up with more copies of themselves, even if they kill their current host. So virulence should be high. And I've chosen this example because there's actually been very careful measurements of the effects of these little nematodes when they're infecting hosts where there's only vertical transmission versus those where there's a lot of horizontal transmission. And what this study found is that reproduction is reduced when there's horizontal disease transmission. So here's the proportion of new hosts that are infected sideways from horizontal transmission in the population. And this is the associated reproductive success of the infected individuals. And where it's only parent to offspring, then there's no harm. Everybody gets to breed. But here, about only 85 to 90% are successfully able to breed because the parasites are reducing their reproduction. With horizontal transmission, it pays the parasite to harm its host. So parasites are nice to their hosts if there's vertical transmission, because that way it enhances their own spread. The host has to be healthy to get them to the next generation. But parasites can evolve to damage to their hosts if it enhances their spread. Now, this leads to a rather worrying pattern in our own population, because human populations have grown extravagantly over the last century or so. We have much higher human population densities, and what we see now, particularly in urban areas and a lot of parts of the earth, is that people are living very, very close to each other. And with that kind of cheek-by-jowl, side-by-side lifestyle comes the opportunity for horizontal transmission, which could select in the parasites that cause us illness, like flu, chickenpox, any number of things, could lead for intense selection through horizontal transmission for much more dangerous levels of virulence. Now, how do hosts respond to parasites? Capuchin monkeys live in South America, and capuchins are cute little monkeys that have this really weird behavior that every now and then they find a millipede, and they can't leave that millipede alone. They don't eat the millipede, but they sort of play with it and bat it around. And a millipede that's pissed off, okay, starts exuding this nasty chemical, okay? And what does a capuchin do except, what? It's got this nasty pissed off millipede and it rubs it against its fur, okay? Well, it turns out that that nasty chemical in the millipede is like DEET. It turns out to be a very powerful mosquito repellent. So these capuchins are actually going around and finding millipedes so that they can reduce the number of mosquito bites that they're going to suffer from. Closer to home, here's the wood rat. This is quite common out in California. And the wood rat is famous because it makes these houses out of sticks in California forests. Now, the forests in where the wood rat lives consist of three different species of tree: bay, toyon, and oak. But the wood rats really seek out the bay trees. That's where they build their nests. And as they're building their nests, they line the nests with bay leaves. But not only do they just line their nests with bay leaves, but they tear the bay leaves, okay? And it turns out that if you look at the effectiveness of these different kinds of torn leaves on fleas, these wood mice, these wood rats, are infected with little fleas. They don't like fleas, but if they line their nests with bay leaves that are torn, the flea larvae can't survive. So, in fact, the bay leaf is a natural fumigant. The mouse has got an insecticide that it uses. Now, our own ancestors, 77,000 years ago, used similar tactics to the wood rat. In some archaeological sites in Africa, there are the remnants of bedding in the caves where people slept. And it's very clear from the layers of bedding, of grass stems and reeds, that these were the same place was used year after year after year. People would sleep on the same place on the floor, okay? Every now and then they would burn them and they'd replace them. And so you've got layers of ashes and you've got bedding and ashes and so on. This is just to show there's a long history of these sites being occupied, people sleeping on them, okay? But they like to use certain kinds of leaves, laurel leaves, okay? Laurel leaves are actually close relatives to bay, and they also are insecticide. So humans would line their earliest beds with an insecticide to reduce the number of lice and fleas. Finally, our diet. You may wonder why some national diets are more interesting than others. People who come from Sweden have got really boring diets, okay? People coming from South Asia, Mexico, wonderful spicy diets, okay? Well, it turns out that these spices are like bay leaves. They are biologically active, and they're antibiotics. So here's the bay leaf right here. This is the one that the wood rat uses to get rid of flea larvae in its nests, okay? And early humans used something like a bay leaf to line their beds with. And if you look at what happens with bacteria, garlic, onion, allspice, all of these are very effective at inhibiting bacterial growth. And it turns out that, well, you know, those spicy diets are found in parts of the earth where you'd have much higher ambient temperature. And so if you didn't completely finish your meal, and you left it sitting on the stove or left it sitting next to the stove, there'd be much worse risk of spoilage in a hot climate than in a cold climate. And so those are exactly the places where people added a lot of spices. That spiciness actually inhibits the bacterial growth, making those safer foods to eat. This is the sort of thing that's kind of informally recognized in one of our local restaurants in Uptown called Chino Latino, which happily advertises itself as saying, if you're a hot enough country, you're cool enough to have your cuisine represented at Red Hot Chino Latino.